Peace of the Lord be with you.
And
good morning and welcome to everyone. We've got a few announcements before we begin.
This is the last day to sign up for poinsettias, so please do so. You know, we have the poinsettias up in the chancel on Christmas Day, and they add to the beauty of that service that day, so please order those today. Tuesday is the deadline for submitting any articles for the newsletter, so if you have anything that needs to go in the January newsletter, please make sure to put those in for that. And then for the schedule for next weekend, for Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, the children's service will be at 5 o'clock Christmas Eve, so next Saturday night at 5 o'clock, so join us for that. And then we will have, because Christmas is on a Sunday, ordinarily we do Christmas at 10 o'clock, because it's on a Sunday, we're going to stick with our usual 9 o'clock on Sunday time. So join us at 9 o'clock next Sunday for Christmas Day, and that'll be a regular divine service, so please join us for that. Let's see here. Then the week after that, we'll be heading out of town, but Terry will be in the office that week, and then the following week we'll be back. I'll be back in the office on Wednesday, and then Wednesday through Saturday that following week, and then she'll be out of the office that week. So if you need anything either week, somebody will be around either week, but the office will be not totally closed this year. So since Terry will be around. So if you have any questions about any of that, obviously please let me or Terry know. So, okay, with that, our opening hymn this morning is hymn 357, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. It's actually, we're going to do it where that's our closing hymn as well. But we'll sing stanzas 1 through 4 of hymn 357, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, and we will sing those after the pealing, sing that after the pealing of the bells.
Thank you.
The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false, and does not swear deceitfully. He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory.
The Old Testament reading for this, the fourth Sunday in Advent, is from the seventh chapter of the book of the prophet Isaiah. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be as deep as Sheol or as high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." And he said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary men that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey, when he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the boy knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land whose two kings you dread will be deserted. The Lord will bring upon you and upon your people and upon your father's house such days as have not come since the day of Ephraim, departed from Judah, the king of Assyria." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the first chapter. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's rise for our Lord's words in the Holy Gospel. This is the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the first chapter.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, Do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, as he did as the angel of the Lord had commanded him, he took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to thee, O Christ.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. And the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Be seated for him today, hymn 361, the little town of Bethlehem, 361. Grace, mercy, and peace be yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning we meditate on the gospel lesson which was previously read. Well, as I think most, if not all of you know, I find history something to be pretty interesting.
But as I said, and I think that there's a way where we can look at the past, look at history, and romanticize it. You know, it might be easy to look at a period of time and think, wow, that is the time when people really had it together. That's when everything was all good. And for some, that period might be hundreds of years ago, where there's a certain perception that society doesn't seem to, you know, follow that the morals and whatnot of the anymore. Or that period could be something more recent. For example, the bliss of our childhood, when things seemed easier and better. As I mentioned history like that, I think you also know that I appreciate church history. And that's just something we can do with the church as well. You know, it can be easy to look at periods in the history of church and think that they had it all together too. We can think about when the first disciples were sent out by Jesus himself and think that there was this monolithic force at work in that sending. Or we can think about the bishops of the Nicene Council and think that they had it all together. Or that maybe the church rallied around someone like Augustine in a uniform fashion. We can romanticize that over and against the images of the church that we see today, where we see the church fractured and splintered. A couple of weeks ago, or maybe it was last week, I can't remember for sure, but I mentioned a comedian who talked about the fact that he was willing to remain Catholic because he understood Roman Catholic in particular, because he understood human frailty. And his point was that the Roman Catholic Church in our time has a reputation that's been, you know, soiled, you could say, in view of charges of things like sexual abuse and the work to cover it up. And as we think about things like that, that can make the appeal, make looking at other times all that much more appealing. You know, we can look at things like that. We can look at the church today and we can think that there's no way it will survive. Surely it will fall apart and it will not continue. We can also look at that and wonder how it is that God can actually accomplish anything through the church to the benefit of Christians to come. But when we take a deeper look at history, we realize that romanticizing it is false. For example, as we look at the history of the church, we can see that there really never was this golden age. Yeah, Jesus sent the disciples out, but even in the New Testament time, we see the dispute between Peter and Paul. Peter wanted to succumb to the Judaizers, as they were called, who wanted the early Christians to be circumcised, and there was a dispute there. The Council of Nicaea itself happened because there was a dispute about how Christ was divine. There were those who wanted to say that he was not as divine as the Father. And with someone like Augustine, as much as he has influenced the Western Church, even at his time, because he wrote in Latin, the Eastern Church really didn't read him. The same thing goes for the things outside of the church as well. When we look at times otherwise, we can realize that there were problems there too. Even in our idyllic childhoods, things still had their own issues. There were many who suffered a great deal. There still were broken relationships. There were children who grew up in homes where there were insufficient resources to provide for their needs. There were those who were mistreated and harmed and abused and shamed for things that they had no control over. So as we look at all this, though, this can make us ask, how then can God progress toward his good ends when all of this was happening? How could God progress toward his good ends even now when all of the things are happening that we see? Well, we can only understand that when we understand that often when God works, he does so in a way that looks messy, that appears even to cover over the goodness that he is working in the midst of it. In other words, we can look at the world out there and it can look really bad, but even in the midst of it, God is working his good through it. As an example of that, we have the story from our gospel lesson this morning. Here in that story, you have Joseph betrothed to Mary. And as I was thinking about this week, I realized there must have been great joy for Joseph in this betrothal, right?
And by the way, a betrothal would have been a big deal, right? The couples would have been betrothed for a year, oftentimes. And my understanding is that they were betrothed for a year at that time to prove that any children from that marriage were from that husband. And that means that this was making this that much more of a big deal, right? That's why it says that Joseph took to divorce her quietly. We think of a breaking of an engagement just as breaking of an engagement, but for them, it was actually a divorce. And so anyway, in any case, they were betrothed. And like I said, I was thinking about how Joseph must have been excited, because surely we know that he was a good and pious Jew, right? And he was excited. He would then be been excited about this forthcoming union with Mary. And Mary, as we also know, was pious. So these two people were probably looking very much forward to this joining, where they would have had this faithful, pious spouse serving in that spousal vocation in a godly way. But then the news came. Mary was pregnant. You can imagine Joseph's shock then. This Mary, who was so pious, what? What kind of hypocrite must she actually be? She seems so faithful. She seems so devoted. But yet, pious Joseph didn't want to drag her name through the mud. So he did the right and pious thing to do. He sought to divorce her quietly. Now, this was both just, because it wouldn't be right for him to take a wife who had been unfaithful during the betrothal. In fact, it was right for him to seek a wife who was a virgin, just as it was right for the wife to expect her husband to also be a virgin. And yet it was also merciful, because he sought to spare her reputation, even spare her life, because the law said that if someone was caught in adultery, that they could be stoned to death. So Joseph sought to do the right thing. He sought to divorce her quietly. But yet he didn't know that in doing the right thing, he was actually going to do the wrong thing. What a mess, right? What I mean is that in this case, he looked at the appearance of things. And he saw in that an adulterous woman he could not marry. And like I said, actually doing the right thing became the wrong thing. And why? Because in this, the Lord was working something contrary to the appearance of what was there. In this story, God had preserved miraculously the integrity and virginity of Mary, but it looked to be something scandalous, didn't it? So what do we learn from this? Well, to start, as I've been talking about God's work sort of generally throughout time and that sort of thing, we see that what appear to be messes and what appear to be scandals and train wrecks actually accomplish something good in the end. The way I often put it is that we're down here playing checkers and God is in heaven playing something far beyond chess. And this just goes to show us that that is true. You look at the mess that is the history of the church, you look at the mess of what goes on around us, and look at what God has accomplished through it. In particular with the church, look at how God has preserved his gospel for you through that mess of a church. He has preserved this gospel that you would hear it today and that you would know of his great love for you and know of your salvation. He has nested faithful people in every generation who, despite their sinful failings, have succeeded in preserving things like the Bible for you to read accurately. I've told you that before, but it's amazing, it's miraculous how accurately the Bible has been preserved and how we can see it. And he has preserved it, and you can have a pastor who preaches it to you. And then look at the cross itself. What a mess the cross is. What worse possible event could there be than the cross? Think about it. On the cross, Jesus died, but what was that? It was the death of a man who had never sinned. It was the death of the one who was God in the flesh. Did Jesus deserve death? Think about it. Why do we die? The wages of
sin is death. All the more did Jesus deserve death at the hands of murderous sinners. No. There is no greater travesty than that the sinless man who is God in the flesh die. There's no bigger travesty than that the holy God suffer the curse of unholy sin. But what did it do? It accomplished the greatest possible thing. Your salvation. So what do we see from that? You can see from that that when you have challenges in your life, that God is actually accomplishing something good in them. And as I say that, I'm sure you've had that experience at some time or another, haven't you? Haven't you had those times that were so hard when you're going through them? And you have all these things going on in your life, around your life, but in the end, that you saw that the Lord accomplished good through them? And to be fair, there are those other times where we have all sorts of difficulties and suffering and that sort of thing, and we don't see how that good was accomplished. Those exist. But many times when all is said and done, we can at least see how God used these hardships, at the least, to draw us to an increased faith in Him. So God's ability to work good things, even through bad, is something we learn in this. Something else we learn relates to how Joseph came to understand what was really going on with Mary. Think about what happened with that. You know, here, Joseph looked at Mary, and he saw a pregnant woman who had been unfaithful. Was that a reasonable response? I would say so, right? If you saw someone who was pregnant, especially someone who was unmarried, what would one of your thoughts probably be? Who's the father, right? Because, after all, there's always a father. That's the way things work, isn't it? But if a woman said that there was no father, she said that this happened without any adulterous act, what would you think? And you can understand Joseph's response. So how did Joseph then get clarification in his understanding? Well, obviously, you know the story. The angel came to him and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit." But to put it in our context, how did Joseph get clarification? Because the reality is, that's a very unique event, and we don't have angels appearing to us most often, right? So in our context, how did he get clarification? He got clarification by the word itself. Right, he looked at the appearance of things and saw one thing, but by the word of God spoken to him, he received an entirely different understanding of what had happened. And Christians, there, we understand how to interpret the world around us as well. When you see the world in shambles, understand God's work through it as he explains it in his word. Understand where that complication comes from. Understand where suffering comes from, where sorrow comes from. When you hear of the things that people do that are bad, about how people are doing things like shoplifting in places because they know that if it's less than $950, they won't be prosecuted. Or when you hear things like abuse cases by priests in the Roman Catholic Church, or if you hear an equally offensive act by a pastor in a Protestant church, or when you commit that same sin that you've been trying to overcome again and again and again, whether it be anger or greed or lust or gossip. Interpret all of that in the light of what the Word says. We are sinners, and sin permeates everything. But look at that Word and how it does reveal what I said before. How it does reveal this work of Christ by which all of that has been overcome. How it reveals the God who works in the midst of these things that are broken. It reveals that one who came named Jesus to save you from your sin. And of course, we know that means that we don't keep sinning, that God's grace can be proven all the more abundant. That's not our calling. Our calling is to be faithful. But it means as you experience the world that falls short,
as you yourself fall short, you know that God is so good that he still works his good out of it. That's what this word reveals. And it also reveals that Jesus still comes to you as Emmanuel, God with us. He came to you as God with you in the waters of baptism, just as he came to Judah yesterday. He comes to you, his people, and he comforts you with his presence, comforts you with the promise that he will never leave you and never forsake you. He comforts you with his very own body and blood and his forgiveness. And so in that, in the midst of this world, does Christ be with you? Does Christ comfort you with his promises? And he comfort you with the joy of his promise to come again. Amen. And may the peace of that Christ guard your hearts and your minds and faith in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Please rise as we join together in singing the offertory hymn found on page 9 of the book. King Ahaz, and in the fullness of time the Word became flesh. Open our hearts and strengthen our faith gladly to receive your Son in the signs where he is present, not in signs of our own choosing, but in the Holy Word and in his sacraments, that we would know and have comfort in these promises of your good work in the midst of all appearances otherwise. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, preserve your apostolic gospel and its ministers. Cause the name and the resurrection of Christ Jesus to be proclaimed among all nations, including among us who are called to belong to him, that the obedience of faith may be brought about in every place. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, it is your will that we live chaste and decent lives in all that we say and do. Preserve all couples who are engaged to be married in faithfulness and honor, that they may come to their wedding day in the blessing and joy of that chastity. Since Christ is Emmanuel, who saves his people from their sins, clothe all brides and grooms in the forgiveness of Jesus, in which all can stand before you cleansed and confident of your blessing. Be also with our homes, that those celebrating your good gifts of birthdays, anniversaries, and other noteworthy occasions, especially Ava Schmidt, Betty Tanzer, and Steve Latman and Chris Perry, would know that joy of your love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, you do not bear with the tiresome flattery and unbelief of kings and rulers forever. Have mercy on us, Lord, and spare our nation. Clear away all empty shows of piety and renew genuine faith in the Virgin Son, that his coming at the last may not be a sign against us. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you named your Son Jesus because he was born to save us from our sins. Give us repentant hearts. Do not let us bow to temptation or abuse his name by seeking our own way, but lead us to confess our sins and rejoice in his salvation. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, look with kindness on the sick and those in any need. Be with those listed in our bulletin: Leslie, Therese, Bob, Ross, Ann, Dan, Nancy and Kent, Jerry, B, Blake, John, Jim, Richard, Rose and her unborn child, Richard, John, Christine, Ken, Jerry, Cassie, Emily, Joanne, Doris, John, Rachel and her unborn child, Ron, the Cooey family, Eleanor, Coolagan family, Jack, Alice, and Bruce, the McDuffie family, Rod, Mary Claire, Ellen, Deborah, Lisa, Kathy, Benjamin, Dorothy, Megan, and her unborn child, Rachel, Joyce, Sean, Levi, Jamie, Leah, Jurgen, Kate, Caitlin, Kurt, Rose, Adam, Kimmy, Elizabeth, and Aaron, Sharon, Don, and Gail, Judy, and Kurt, Vanessa, Ted, Megan, and Gideon, Noah, Athey, Amelia, Jennifer, Zachary, Mike, Alan, Nancy, and Jessica, and Judah. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who is truly Lord and ruler of the house of Israel. With the Holy Spirit, you spoke to Moses out of the burning bush and gave the law and terror to test your ancient people, that the fear of you would be before them. As Moses stretched out his arm at your word to bring Israel out of bondage, and as he stood in the breach against your wrath, so you have given Christ to redeem us with his arms outstretched on the wood of the cross. Grant that, as we recall with thanksgiving his advent in the flesh, we may always confess him and remain watchful for his advent in glory at the last day. For you live and reign, one God, forever and ever, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to
do. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, whose way John the Baptist prepared, proclaiming him the promised Messiah, the very Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and calling sinners to repentance that they might escape from the wrath and be revealed when he comes again in glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul. In the one true saving faith to life everlasting, depart in peace.
Amen.
We continue. The Nunc Dimittis is found on page 12 of the bulletin. Sent your only begotten Son into the flesh. We thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in the sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
We continue with our closing hymn. Stanzas are opening hymn, hymn 357, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. We'll sing stanzas 5 through 7. Hymn 357, stanzas 5 through 7.